We passed our strategic plan earlier this year, and it's between 2016 and 2019, so it guides our organization for the next 3 years. We have 7 objectives within our strategic plan, and the first one is in relation to suicide prevention. We released the National Inmate Suicide Prevention Strategy this summer, in July, and in it, we want to change the way Inuit and the rest of Canada thinks about our interaction with suicide and suicide prevention. Canada was transfixed this spring on Attawapiskat and other Indigenous suicide stories. It was even an emergency debate in the House of Commons, which talked about the need for action. But a lot of the discussion was based on a couple of different things. First, an individual perspective on what is a public health policy issue. For some reason, in this field, an individual perspective can replace a public policy best practice, evidence-based. The other thing that I notice is that the answers seem to lie with those most affected, and also the issues are focused around the time when people are in crisis. So we want to think about this issue, the country wants to think about this issue as one that is Indigenous youth, and they want to talk about this through the lens of attempts and completions. And I don't think that we deal with any of our public health policy issues like that. And the WHO says that suicide is a largely preventable public health crisis. But somehow, and in Quebec, there is a strategy that has lowered the rate of youth suicide by over half in the last 12 years. It's possible. We know that we come from a low suicide reality. Elevated rates of suicide only started happening in the late 1970s. We're empowered by this data, this evidence. So we set out to create an evidence-based, Inuit-specific suicide prevention strategy that's globally informed. And the outputs of it, and this is when it comes to self-determination, is the idea that we won't get where we need to go without social equity. Housing, education, and healthcare are the key foundations of social equity. And when we have 40% overcrowding rates for housing, and when our educational attainment rates are approximately 30% high school graduation for our adult population, or when we have 250 times the tuberculosis rates of all the Canadians that were born in Canada, we have a long way to go on social equity. So it goes from the society where we have huge challenges that then spur on negative consequences at the community level and at the family level. We know that we have historical trauma. We know that we haven't had the ability to heal from all those things that happened to us in the 1950s and 60s, and that now have been cast upon the subsequent generations of Inuit. These things are not ethereal. They are practical. There are practical understandings on these concepts, and the inability for the Canadian public or the government to accept that there's cause and effect, and that even before we talk about mental health services or providing the specific care to all those who are in need, and to do all that we can to safeguard against people who are at risk, those are all necessary, but they are secondary in many ways to a transformative societal shift that needs to take place to ensure that we are not creating risk factors for suicide. If you live in Inuit Nunanak, you and your children are at higher risk for suicide. And it doesn't matter how many protective factors you have, or how successful you are, or how strong your personal mental health is. The fact that we are encompassing entire populations with risk factors that then spill into society means that no matter who you are affected. You know somebody who's died by suicide. You have been put in situations where there has been crisis. You or your family members have been abused. 50% of Inuit women in the Inuit Health Survey reported being abused sexually in childhood. That is a reality, and it's unacceptable, and we need to change it. So all of these different things come together to create a national Inuit suicide prevention strategy. And we did this together. It wasn't a couple of people at ITK that created this document. The National Inuit Committee on Health, the Adelaide Mental Wellness Subcommittee, the Mental Health Commission of Canada, Health Canada, especially with support from with their Inuit Health, First Nations Inuit Health Branch, and the board of ITK and the National Inuit Committee on Health, of which there are members here today, all worked on this together. And it is our statement to Canada. And once again, we're saying, this is what we want. And what's interesting then, in this time of reconciliation and self-determination, is how is Canada going to perceive that? How are the academics in this room, whose field it is in mental health, going to receive it? Are you going to pick it apart? Are you going to say that it's not really what you want? Or perhaps a part of it's good, but the rest of it, you know, could be improved. Or will you accept this is what Inuit have said to Canada is what we need, and work with us to achieve that goal through the way in which we've decided to move towards it. And that is the way in which everyone, all Canadians, can play a role in self-determination for Inuit, is to accept that we have things to say, and that we do it in a way that respects our people, and also respects human knowledge. The fact that our suicide prevention strategy is globally informed and evidence-based, that can sit right alongside Inuit-specific. And there doesn't have to be a qualification there. It all matters, and why wouldn't we use the best of the world and the best of what we know, but also know our communities and ourselves enough to know things that might not work even if they've worked in other places. So in suicide prevention, the way forward on self-determination is through listening to Inuit. We talked about housing. Housing is our second priority. And I want to also think about self-determination in housing. For most of Canada, the idea of housing, there's a private housing market, then there's also a rental market, and there's social housing. And people usually float between those three in their lifetime. Perhaps in university, you're in a dorm, so you're in an assisted rental situation. Those markets and that structure came to be over the course of the history of Canada. But housing in Inuit Nunanak and the infrastructure in Inuit Nunanak writ large came about in fits and starts, and wasn't ever meant to be a long-term solution. We're not a people that had private housing markets before contact and before core settlement into our communities. So the idea that now we would be able to figure it out in 20 or 30 or 40 years is really a hindrance to what the work that needs to be done. We still don't have a sustainable housing model. In parts of Inuit Nunanak, we have private home ownership. The majority of our people live in social housing. There's without a true sustainable transition into any other form of housing. So the task in front of us today is to understand that there is a massive need, 40% overcrowding, as I've mentioned. But there is also a question on the floor that hasn't been answered. And you can get into as much discussion as you want about the cool, new, innovative designs for housing. That still doesn't get us to a sustainable housing solution. It is a component of it. But this, the idea for Southern Canada is you build equity through your home. It is an essential building block for your own personal worth, and then it is something that you pass on in your generations and accumulates wealth over time. That is the model. So for Inuit, what is the model? How do we create a sustainable housing structure? Next week there'll be an Inuit Housing Summit, and we'll be talking about these issues. But these are also academic questions as well. Perhaps there are solutions that we haven't thought of yet. Perhaps there are partnerships that we have. But the idea on self-determination in housing is not that we just need a lot of money and that we need to keep building the same sort of structures and the same governance models that we already have. It is to reimagine what is possible and then try to go ahead and achieve it. It's the same thing for infrastructure. If you think about who built the infrastructure in Nunavut, a lot of it was built by the US military. They proved in the late 40s and early 50s that you can build long-term sustainable infrastructure in the Arctic. And we still don't have that second wave that fills in from that first wave, which was dominated by Cold War considerations and by a government that isn't our own. So all those distance early warning sites that we pass when we're going on our trips, or the airstrips that we probably fly on every time we go to the Arctic, in Goose Bay or in Iqaluit. Who do you think built those? And what does that say about our place within Canada? That we don't have a second phase of building Canada that is now built upon the sustainability of our communities and our society instead of Cold War and sovereignty interests. The third objective within our strategic plan is reconciliation. And this is an interesting one. The Government of Canada has made it their priority to talk about reconciliation, and has done very unilateral things in this process. You think of on day one, the name change between from Aboriginal Northern Affairs, I think it was, Northern Development, to Indigenous Affairs, Northern Development, whatever it is. It's a new item. But we didn't work with the government to change that name. No, there is no letter that you can find from three Indigenous groups in Canada that says we request the government of Canada to start using the term Indigenous instead of Aboriginal. And that's just think about that point. It shows the transparency of where we are today rather than the communicated space that the federal government wants to have with us. Is it one of empathy and sympathy and working together in partnership and renewed relationship? I believe that's possible. I believe we'll get there. But reconciliation isn't easy, and it isn't in changing terms to fit your political end goal. So reconciliation is not just something that you do today that you didn't do yesterday. It is premised on action. So the missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls inquiry, or the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's 94 calls to action, or the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, their acceptance and implementation are two different things. Accepting that they exist and saying that they're important allows for the Canadian government and Canadians to think that we're actually doing something, when it isn't until we have implementation plans associated with each one of those things that are done from the ground up with Indigenous people, such as Inuktitut Reconnaissance and our lengthened organizations, that we actually are doing something different than we did yesterday. And that's where reconciliation breaks down. Everyone wants in on reconciliation today, but that often you want in on non-Indigenous terms. You don't want true partnerships. You just want to be branded with that term and feel good about the fact that you're doing something for us, with us. So my central tenet on reconciliation is it's not as easy as it looks, and it should be hard. If you think about the residential school existence and the entirety of the residential school structure, and then you juxtapose that with other cultural genocide events that happen across the world, and you think about the lack of change in the way that we talk about our history and the individuals that are within our history, based on what we know now about the true intent of residential schools, and the fact that there were whistleblowers in the 1920s, there were people that spoke out against the treatment of Indigenous people, and there was inaction, and there was actually people that were in charge of implementing these racist policies that killed thousands of children. And yet our history books don't change to reflect the enormity of that atrocity, that no individuals have to bear the brunt of that history. That somehow with Indigenous people, it still remains in a societal issue. That was a different time. The societal norms were different. I would hope that if I did anything like what happened, that I was responsible for anything like what happened to those children in residential school, that history would not treat me kindly, and that the good deeds that I've done today would be then recast into the reality in which of the actions in which I let happen. And I hope that we all would think that of ourselves, that the things that we do today, some of them may seem to be wrong in the future, like, oh, I really shouldn't have supported that particular program, or those socks look awful on me. You have these things where you regret things in the future, but then there are objective truths, and the truths that we find out over time that many researchers in this room have helped uncover. And that's when we have to think differently about our past and about the people who we lift up and the people that we still consider to be heroes and the new place that we have to then reconcile with. So I hope that reconciliation does include a change in the way people think about those past actors, because the world has accepted nothing less in other places where genocide has happened, and it shouldn't be the same here in Canada. Number four is in relation to education. It's interesting that reconciliation and education in our strategy come together. And I've already talked a little bit about not accepting the present when it comes to education. And I've given this example before, and just think about this. I have a 9-year-old and a 7-year-old. Pani Usyk is 9, Jusha is 7. They were lucky enough to be able to go to daycare in Inuktitut. That isn't a reality that all Inuit children can have. They can go to school in Inuktitut from kindergarten to grade 4. But there is nowhere in Canada that I can move where my child can then continue to go to school in his first language beyond grade 4. And the first day of school last year, this is when my eldest was going into grade 3, he, and this was before I became ITK president, he had asked me, Tato, can we move somewhere where I can still go to school in the next year? And to think that I would have to go to Greenland to make that happen makes no sense. 60% of all Inuit in Canada, no matter how much language loss we have, still say that Inuktitut is our mother tongue. The fact that we cannot create a bilingual education system is our failing, and it's our failing of our children. It isn't the failing of the federal government or a province or a territory by itself. It is what our parents and our grandparents wanted for us. And it's something that we have to do more to achieve. So the construct of why we have education, what is K-12 education for? Do we look back, do we reconsider this? What do our communities want our children to? What skills and abilities do we want them to have by the time they're 18? And if you empower local communities to answer those questions and create curriculums that satisfy those questions with answers that empower our society and our communities, then we'll have real success, not only in our K-12 system, but also our early childhood development, and also then going on to post-secondary. The world's leading institutions in post-secondary, the students who go to them don't come from unreality. There are a myriad of ways to get the skills necessary to compete in the global environment and to get the best quality education. And often we have not thought beyond the things that service delivery agents can provide. Teacher accreditation. Is there any magic in a four-year BA? It's not to put anyone down who has taken it and is a wonderful teacher from it. But it was only the 1970s that many people who were taught in Canada were taught by teachers who went to normal school for a year and then were taught on the job in a sort of an apprentice-style manner, who have become amazing teachers and have generated the children who go through those systems and then go on to post-secondary and lead those societies. But somehow, we're stuck in saying that we don't have enough teachers. We don't have enough teachers who speak Inuktitut. And we don't know how to get from here to there without massive influxes of cash to teach the same way that we're already teaching, when there are other ways to do it. I'm going off script, I think, from the positions that ITK has at the moment. But I'm doing that with a purpose. I am putting this to the room. So some of these things you'll see, I'm specifically vague about ITK said that. But this is an academic setting. We are in a university. What do you do in post-secondary, and what do you do with all higher education? You contemplate questions, and you try to find answers that move our society forward. So this is what I'm trying to do today. Number five of seven is the environment. Last week I was on Power and Politics, and I hopefully was heard by more than just my social media following. And in it I talked about reconciliation and climate change being just as close a fit as the economy and climate change. So Minister McKenna, the Prime Minister, many different jurisdictions have talked about the need to link climate change and the economy. Now, whatever you think of that concept, you should also be thinking of the concept of reconciliation and climate change. Isn't this one of the foundational tenets of our differences between non-Indigenous Canadians and Indigenous Canadians? The way that we treat the environment, the way that we look at our natural world, the love that we have for our species that live within our environment, the fact that we consider ourselves a part of our environment and that we do not dominate it or control it. If Canadians can't understand these concepts and don't accept them, then we will have the response to the Paris Declaration, the framework for action in Canada, that focuses on an economic reality that all Canadians are concerned about. the idea that they would also be concerned about our health and our well-being. And our wish to ensure that our environment stays intact. Those are new concepts. And so I would say that that would be a reconciliation moment if the government of Canada and provinces and territories and all Canadians would just accept that the way in which we interact with our environment and our and the way in which climate change will affect us is foundationally and fundamentally different than the way that it will affect them. It isn't about gas going up another 10 cents. It isn't about not being able to skate on the Rideau Canal for two more weeks during the year. This is about the entirety of our society staying intact. And I don't think today that there is a great enough appreciation for that. Number six is in relation to research. And this is something that we talked about this morning. We had a panel of self-determination research. So we had panelists from across Inuit Nunavut talking about what activities we're undertaking in relation to self-determination research. But at the national level and at our level, we still don't have the ability to partner and participate in research the way that we need to. There are no Inuit that are on governing councils and tri-councils in any one of the agencies. Now, we can be excluded from the room because of a credentials argument, right? Even though we do have credentialed people. There are Inuit in all sorts of fields, and so I will never say that there is no Inuk that isn't a master's or a PhD, because there probably is. But the idea that we don't have a right to be in the room, when the tri-councils are an agency of government and have political control from ministers responsible for allocating funds and then providing high-level strategic direction, just says that it's okay for them to bend their own rules that suit their governance model. But when it comes to us, it's a hard and fast reality. That no, we couldn't do that. We couldn't provide Inuit representation at the highest levels of CIHR or SHRC, because that isn't how it works. But somehow a minister is able to completely change the direction of the way in which these organizations run and function. This is the challenge that we face, is that it's a combination of knowledge and shared purpose, but also respect. So there is a shared purpose. We want the best for our research. We have a multitude of research questions that we need answered. We don't even know the ideation rates for suicidality in our regions. In the creation of our Indian suicide prevention strategy, we had to go and dig through coroner data to even get the rates of Inuit-specific suicide in each one of our regions. We had to do that ourselves. We have basic gaps in knowledge. We also have a basic lack of respect for our people in the governance model that dictate how monies are spent and who gets them. And these are things that need to change. It's part of this dream that we all, I think, have to have about self-determination, is that the constructs you had about who's in and who's out have to change. The idea that we are excluded from rooms because we aren't the foremost expert that is peer-reviewed, that has been selected by a panel to take one space within 15, versus we have knowledge that no matter how smart you are in a non-Indigenous setting, you will never know the Inuit reality. It's the way that you may know it. That is the fundamental shift that I hope we can all see. And that is the self-determination approach to research at the national level that I hope we can usher in this new era of Inuit to Crown and nation to nation. The last point on self-determination is in relation to health and well-being. And Inuit get tired of hearing about the gaps in outcomes. And our rates drive researchers to us. There are very few places in the world where you can have research findings that attract a national interest because they are so bad. And there are such broad discrepancies between the Inuit-specific reality and the Canadian reality. And so these are questions that need to be answered. But it goes beyond that. We have a better understanding now of our health condition. We understand what we need to do to try to solve it. The question is, how can we work in partnership with governments to create the solutions that we know are necessary? I think that we'll look back on this time as hopefully the end of inaction. I'm a huge fan of Cindy Blackstock and the work that she does for the First Nations Caring Society and for all Indigenous children. And if you think about that, the specific things that organization has uncovered about the basic inequity between what is spent on Indigenous children versus spent on non-Indigenous children in one particular point in our health and social services spectrum. I think that you would imagine if we had 100 Cindy Blackstocks, there would be 100 different examples that are equally as powerful. And so that is the challenge of our time as well, is to create social equity within health and our social reality that allows for us to move forward and take advantage of self-determination in a way that our ancestors did, in a way that we know that we can moving forward. I appreciate your attention here today. I hope that we can work together moving forward. And I also thank all of you who have done amazing work in this room on behalf and with and for Inuit. Thank you.